I really can't give any advice. I mean, if you want it, yes, I can. Do it now. Don't worry. If you're 20 years old, you know, don't give up the whole game, because you need money in this world no matter what. But you don't need a lot of it. But do it. Don't say, I will, because 95% of the people in this country, especially when you're traveling out here, you say, boy, I wish I would have done that.
I'm here today with Lou, who lives the traveling lifestyle. You could say that he lives the nomadic lifestyle. And he and I have known each other for a few years now. When I first met Lou, he had built out his own trailer with the boat building skills that he's acquired over the years. And we have an interview of that on record, but since then he's rebuilt his van better. And I have a wind muff, which I didn't have before, and kind of affected the first one. So now with the wind muff and the new trailer, and maybe we can even get some upgrades since Lou's built his first trailer that he'll share with us. But he's got a really good story. I like what he's done with his rig, and a lot to offer the nomadic community with that. I give you Lou.
How's it going, man?
It's going great.
So tell us a little bit about, for folks that don't know anything about you, your background and how you arrived at living a traveling lifestyle.
Kind of been a wandering vagabond most of my life. Sailboats were my thing. Did a lot of sailing, which was my trade, boat building and boat delivery. And I would stay in places for a certain amount of time, but always had the lust to go and look over the other side and see what was greener. I'm 67, almost 68, and a few years ago I decided it's time enough to sell my property. After 208, shit hit the fan. So I decided to build something like this. I wasn't sure what I was going to build, different shapes. Ended up with kind of the Vardo shape for many reasons. Cost, ease, lightweight, lots of other factors. And started building it. Had a little operation, got ill, and that really convinced me that it's time to do something now before I can't do it at all. So I hit the road. Been on the road ever since.
Having sold your house, you probably were in the position that you could have just gone and bought another RV or an RV outright. Why did you choose to go through all of the time and labor to build your own living space rather than just go out one that's already been built from the factory?
A few reasons. One, the industry for the most part is just junk. It's the way of the world, unfortunately, anymore. You pay a lot of money and it doesn't last. I mean, a new Lance camper I think is well into the 30,000s for, if you're gonna live in it full time for any length of time, it's not gonna serve you. That's one reason. I like uniqueness. It just makes me happier and I feel like it's something that I can be proud of. I have the skills to build this stuff because I've been doing it for 50 years. It went fairly quick on this because of the shop I had and the tools and my ability to do this. So that wasn't too big of a deal. I probably would have bought this if it was available. You can't get anything. So after the operation, I didn't feel like working much. This was almost done. And I had some help from friends to get it done, but I had the money. I had the sale of my house, which was pretty much all profit. And that's in a kitty stuck away someplace. I wanted something that was extremely well insulated, lightweight, number one priority for me, because I have to pull it with something. And I don't have a lot of money, and I have a very small Social Security. I live on $700 a month, and I do it just fine. But gas is my biggest thing, so I'm always thinking about how to make that stretch. And lightweight equates to horsepower. So this I could build extremely light, pull it with anything just about. I just happen to have a 150 Ford truck, so that's my mode. And all those reasons are led up to me deciding to build. And really my mindset is I don't think about buying anything much unless it's a guitar, something like that, toys. I build everything just because that's the way I've always been. I can get what I want. I can stretch the cost out also too, which I've done most of my life. This time I had the funds to do it full time, but you can, you know, if you got to spend $15,000 building something, you can take 5 years if you have the time. But, so all those reasons.
I would also notice that the way this is laid out, I don't normally see a door on the back of an RV or a camper and the bed up front like that. Was the layout a consideration too?
Yeah. The door was on the side on some of my designs, but as you can see here, this isn't very big. It's 54 inches. That's a tiny door. And also it's cabinets all the way around both sides. So that would take up that section of usable storage space inside if I did that. So to do this shape, it almost has to be back here. For one, for headroom, and again, taking up space inside. I like the door back there because of this little lounging area. It's your patio area, so to speak. And I spend a lot of time out here. So it's nice. But the door could go anywhere if this was bigger. And I didn't want it any bigger for reasons I mentioned earlier.
Would you mind sharing what the overall end cost was for you to build this out, start to finish?
No, not at all. Originally, we'll just back up just a second. This okay. was the, in the first video, if anybody has seen it, this was the end of the unit. It was 11 feet long, 7 feet wide out here. Floor under the corbels are 5 feet. And that was plenty for me. I had everything that I have in there now, shower, toilet, sink, the whole deal. This section is 4 feet. A year ago, I decided I wanted ice cubes and ice cream. So I wanted a bigger freezer. I had a little tiny freezer in my 12-volt refrigerator, but I wanted something bigger. The company that I have, NovaCool, makes a wonderful floor freezer, regular chest freezer. So I thought, well, that's cool. I could put that in. Yeah, no place to put it. I was going to put it in my truck. Nah, that's not going to work. Long story short, I decided, well, I'll just refab this thing. But I was at my weight limit on my chassis. So I had to build a whole new custom chassis, lift it off, put it on here, and then I built this section, 4 feet more. I'm also a guitar player, and my electric and amp and everything was in my truck. Was a pain in the ass to get to it lots of times. I had other stuff on top of it. So now that's a guitar room, everything's there, and I got my ice cubes, and I have my ice cream right there. So plus, there's other things in it other than ice cubes and ice cream. It's very economical because I can really stock up on buys and stuff and freeze stuff. Other than fresh food, I can go months. So, back to your question, this was added. Originally, I had about $7,000 in it. I had 300 watts of solar, 2 6-volt batteries, and the unit, which was just fine. A lot of that was wood that I had left over from boat projects, so the cost would have been a little bit more for the average person, but it's very doable, for, especially if you scrounge. Everything I bought new, my composting toilet, my panels, everything, I didn't hunt around. I just wanted to get it done. I've added, probably cost me around $3,500 to do this. The freezer alone was $1,000. So at today's prices, if you didn't shop around, if you just did what I did, I'm saying 12 to 15,000, and maybe a little bit less. Chassis aren't very expensive, used trailers and stuff, and then you can convert them. This shape, it's hard to find one on the used market without doing extensive work to it. So it was much easier for me to build one from scratch than to convert an old boat trailer or whatever. But a guy could build you one of these for a couple grand if you just paid a professional to do that suspension and everything.
Okay, oh, you're just talking about the trailer, though, and the price, about $12,000, give or take, is minus the labor that you put into it.
That's material cost.
Okay.
Yeah. Obviously, you know, that's nothing for the home builder, myself, or anybody that's going to do it themselves. And there's nothing really exotic about this thing. I mean, if you can use a skill saw and a saber saw, and you're patient, most everybody can do this. Not everybody, but most everybody can do this kind of stuff. And the information is there. With the internet nowadays, it's available. You know, just sit down, go to YouTube, and you've got all how to do fiberglass work, and, you know, how to weld, and everything, all that is available. So,
did you draw up plans?
Well, yeah, kind of, just sketches. I built models. I always built models of boats before I built them, a scale. You take what they call taking the lines off, taking the dimensions off, something small to make it big. And I did that with this. I built a few different models of different shapes. And then once I got my mindset that I'm going to do this Bardo gypsy looking thing, then I built a scale model of it and put little pieces of scale stuff in there, people and tables and this kind of stuff. And it looked like it was going to fit. So then I built the shell. And the shell is just framed like a home. It's just stick framing walls, insulated, skinned. Top, same thing. The radius is just with sawn beams or laminated beams. You could do it either way to get the round radius. And that would be the only real difficult part for somebody that hasn't done it. But it's very doable. It's not a big deal to make a round roof. So then I had this box, and then I just kind of went inside and stretched and, work can go here, what's going to work. The shower was a major thing. I wasn't going to sacrifice not having a shower. So I had to have a composting toilet area with a shower stall all in one. So there was more thought in that than everything else. Everything was straightforward. I knew what size bed. I knew how high it was, storage under. I like to cook. I like to eat. So I wanted a nice galley, two burners on the stove, prep area, sink. It's not plumbed, per se. It's all gravity flow water. I have a gray water tank for the sink, and the shower drains either into a false floor, or I have a petcock underneath that comes straight out in either a 5-gallon bucket or right into the desert for the gray. So that's simple. And then everything else is 12 volt, other than a small inverter for my little tablet and my phone, that kind of stuff.
Mind giving us a walk around?
If you just ask what you, this storage, every inch needs to be storage in this lifestyle, no matter what you have. So it all, I carry stuff that I want to take inside or put in my truck. Mainly jack stands, blocking, chalks, all those. I have another one on the other side. Go in there.
What kind of paint did you use on the outside?
This is just regular old latex house paint. It's tough as nails once it dries, and it's durable, I mean, forever. Easy to clean, and it's inexpensive.
Okay.
And that's just rolled right over the plywood that I used for this thing. I used home windows, double pane. Insulation was a big factor.
Double pane windows, where would somebody find those?
Anywhere. Home Depot, Lowe's, any hardware place, any window supply. These are.
And what do they run price-wise?
These little ones I had custom made through the company. It wasn't too much more, but that, what they call it, 2030. 3 foot. I think I paid $120.
Okay.
Yeah. Screens, everything. So.
Double pane, screens, and everything.
Yeah. You can't build something for that, time-wise.
Anymore. Sure.
So, this was added a year and a half ago. Removable. I have 40 foot of wire on this thing, so I can set it out someplace if I find that I need it. It rarely comes off. It's also tiltable. I have 450 on top. This is 100. That's adequate.
Let me see if I can get up and show that.
Those are 3 150s up there.
3 150s, and then the side panel.
100.
So 450 watts of solar.
550.
550, excuse me.
But I started with just two panels.
Okay.
When I added the freezer and the redo, I was a little concerned about the freezer. It's very economical on electricity, but I didn't want to get stuck someplace 2 or 3, 4 days in a storm, whatever, cloudy. So I added two more batteries and one more big panel, and then this guy when I did this add-on. And I have a ton of power. Nothing has even come close. I've never been under 85% battery loss overnight. I use between 20 and 60 amps in a overnight period. Depends on the weather, and hot and cold, obviously. Stuff's running more now, the refrigerator, and that, because of the heat here. It's mid-80s. But I don't use a lot. You know, I have 464 amps there, and really 50% of that is usable on the safe side for your battery. So I have plenty of power.
Can we take a look at your batteries?
Sure. Let me grab my key.
Okay.
Piece of cooking oil.
Uh-oh. Oh, wow. It's quite a bank of batteries.
Yeah, it's a lot, but it's a comfort to know that I have, and I won't run out. I've went about 6 days with pretty much no sun at all. That's the longest. And still, I mean, it still produces, you know, even in a cloudy day, you'll get a trickle.
How many amp hours is this?
These U.S. batteries are 232 apiece.
Okay.
But they're just what they call series parallel. The batteries are wired in series, but it's a parallel system from the in and the out.
Okay.
Once you get multiple batteries, you have to do it that way for this 12-volt system. So 464 total.
464 total, so you're looking at north of 230 amps usable, yeah?
Yeah, and you can go past that. It's just not, the batteries don't like that over a period of time.
Okay.
You know, you want to keep it up the best you can. But my system, like I say, I've never been, 85% is the lowest I have ever gotten. That's a ton of power. And I'm conservative, yet the refrigerator and the freezer run 24 hours a day, and I figure 50% of the time. Sometimes less, sometimes a little bit more. And when everything is said and done at the end of the day, when it's not charging, then I check it every day. I have a battery monitoring system also inside, and I'll go, it'll be maybe resting at about 13.8. I'll get up in the morning and it's about 12.6 to 12.8, and I've used anywhere from, like I said, 20 to 60 amps, depends on what I've done. Watch TV unlimited if I wanted to, if the thing's running, the two appliances. Lights, nothing, they're all LEDs. I have an amplifier for electric guitar, and it doesn't burn a lot, but I can play that. Charge my tools, yeah. It's plenty of power. I could get by with less.
What would you say that the cost of your power to install something this substantial would be for somebody watching this and they want as much power as you have? About what could they expect to pay out of pocket in the materials?
Well, these batteries now are about $150 a piece, give or take $10. It depends on where you buy them. So there's $600. A good controller. By the way, this is a PWM system, and there's a million arguments over PWM and MPPT. My quick view is PWM is just fine for anything under 500 or 600 watts of power for us doing this lifestyle. There's a whole bunch of advantages to the other MPPTs, but primarily for larger systems, homes and stuff, which is the way it's evolved to, and that's what it's designed for. But whatever your choice is, it does the same. This is less money and easier to hook up. So that's the way I've done it. And I've also done this for many years on a semi-professional level. I'm not an electrician, I'm a boat builder, but I've installed these systems on boats and other small homes and that kind of stuff, when that's all that was available. And I like lead acid batteries. Again, cost and longevity. If the system is good and wired correctly, I get 8 years out of a battery. No problem. So that's why I go with that way. So back to the cost. You got that. This is $100 direct from China to my door with 40 foot of lead and two MC4 connectors. Dirt cheap nowadays. Those are a little more, but not much. I think I paid $200 apiece, $190 apiece through a guy in Portland for those up there. So I probably have, you know, $1,500 in everything. Good controller, spend money on the controller, don't skimp on that. That's not labor. You know, you're gonna double that or more at an RV place if you just go pay some. But watch out for those RV solar installers.
Okay.
Yeah. Most of them don't know one end of a wire from another, so.
Okay.
Yeah, find somebody like Jamie. Or anybody that has done it that you could trust, you know. And you can get it done reasonably. And again, this stuff's not rocket science either. That information is available. And it's pretty straightforward to do if you've never done any 12-volt stuff. That's available to anybody.
Let's see what's on the other side. You have your full-size truck with a, what, small block V8?
Yeah.
That you pull it with?
Yeah.
Which you can find a lot of these on Craigslist nowadays with, you know, 100,000, 150,000 miles on them for maybe $3,000, something like that.
So, I've liked this truck, so I've kept it. And I put $4,000 into it last year. Rebuilt the suspension, new shocks, batteries, you know, new tires, everything.
Just do it over on this side of you. Say on this side of you.
And storage is everything, even in here. You know, I don't have a lot of tools. First year I had a lot of hand tools, and now it's a cordless drill and wrenches and things just to service any emergency, and that's it. But everything kind of has a home in here too, so I don't have to, you know, drag boxes out and look for stuff, and I can get to it real quick. And it just drives me crazy if I don't have something I can get to right now. So,
right.
Some people say that's anal, but I think it's practical.
Sure. I see you have a Clearstream 2 antenna.
Yep, works great. That's one of the reasons I have that is because of you, because you had one, and a few other people.
They pick up a pretty good signal, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. I don't, haven't even put it up yet, and I'm getting like 28 or 30 channels off somewhere over there.
I'll tell you where it is. It's
over here.
It's I'll tell you exactly where it is. It's right there, right the nose of your truck is pointing.
Right over there.
Some
yeah.
Tape, but. It's right there.
You know, there's nothing on except for a bunch of crap, but I do get both all three PBS channels, so.
You get MeTV?
I get MeTV.
Robert They're, Mitchum?
Yeah, I get that occasionally, yeah. And Bonanza, but it's easy to put it up. It sits in a little pocket there, and I just put it up on top of that pole, and it just fits on top, and then I can rotate it and get an exact, but it's getting everything I need right now, so.
One of the things that I like about this build right off the top that I'm noticing on this side is you mounted your fan over where you want your fan without regard to it being in the center of the RV. And that, I think that's an important point for folks to note watching this. If you buy yourself a fantastic fan or a Maxxair fan, put it where you want that air to come in and go out. With no regard to whether it's at the center. It doesn't have to be in the center of your rig.
No, so. Obviously with panels, you know, before I added the panels, I could have put it in the center rig, but that's over the, close to the stove and kind of central, you know, so it'll take stuff out, you know, fumes of the stove. And I sit close to that, the bunk is close to that, so it's a good area to do it, but that's a great point you make. Put it where it's gonna have its most use, not just because it's convenient to put it over there. Yeah, you can put it anywhere. A little challenge when you put something flat and square on around something. So in the boating world, you know, we just do what we call a combing like that, and that's just you make it flat, and then the appliance that you buy just screws down normally, so it's not a big deal. It's just the framework is a little bit different.
Gotcha. Yeah. Got yourself a little table for cooking or whatever.
Yeah, I do all, mainly it's washing. But I do set the barbecue on there occasionally. I have a little Weber. And when it's warm, I do all that out here. Just because it's so much less hassle to clean up inside, and it's, I got more room, and it's just nice to wash dishes out here. And that it, everything goes in here. This is water. This is to prevent algae from growing. I found the first year that if I didn't cover this son of a bitch, I had a green swimming pool of algae
right.
And frogs in there.
That's a good idea. So you just cover your water jug outside so it doesn't
It helps protect the UV from, you know, getting that in there. And then all my washing stuff just goes in this little toolbox thing.
Like a toolbox.
Yeah, and that just fits in here when I'm traveling, and it's all ready to go. And this just folds up. And
a couple windows on this side. You've got a awning that's looks like a quick on and off awning made by ARB.
Yep.
What did that run you, if you don't mind me asking?
I think this one is right at 200, 100, 190, something, maybe 170, I forgot. But for what it is, it's well worth it. It's inexpensive, it's high quality, and a reasonable price. I had $100 in making one. The one I had, the round green tarp thing, $100 in that, and it took forever to put up and take down. It looked quaint, but. This thing here, and I've had this in well over 20 mile an hour winds.
Yeah.
Yeah, that really works well. And I can get it off and stored if the winds come up heavy really quickly.
But it's a super durable fabric that they use to make these with, and the convenience of having something made from the factory rather than having all of the grommets and posts that we use. I know with my awning it takes a lot of time, so sometimes I don't use my awning as much as I would as you do, because you've got such convenience. And so I'm a big fan of the ARBs, and with this mat that you have that you're standing on, it creates a very welcoming and warm environment right here at the entrance. Looks like you've got your solar shower going there, warming up for...
Oh, I'm cheating. Actually, that's my... it is doing its solar thing, but this is my reservoir, and that's something that's new in the rig that we can talk about.
Okay.
For my... I added a on-demand hot water system.
Okay.
And they're touchy. I don't know if I'm the first one to figure this out. I doubt it, but I have found the key to making those things work efficiently and take all that touchiness away from it. And one of it is a storage container. We can talk about that a little
Shall
bit.
Shall we go inside?
Sure.
And start?
You don't need to take your shoes off. I'll don't worry. I just do it because it's habit.
Coming in.
Yeah, so
I'm just going to do a quick look and then I'm just going to keep coming.
This is the freezer.
What brand is that?
Nova Cool.
Okay.
Same as my refrigerator here. It's
Nova
strictly
Cool.
12 volt.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
just pull that a little bit behind.
Yes, I will.
Not all of us, the bugs.
Sure.
Kind of like a big dog house, that's the Yeah.
And immediately what comes to mind is the boat feel that I get stepping in here with the curved lines and the woodwork trim and the way that your bed frame is made. It's these places where you're storing things, where things can shift about in motion but not come out of where they are supposed to be. I really like the inside of this, man. Can you talk a little bit about it?
Well, yeah, it's influenced obviously by what I've done on boats. So it's really quick and dirty construction. I mean, for what I would do for a client, you know, I'd have drawers on pulls, and but bins and stuff like this, you know, even not having just a bin, this takes a little bit more work, but not much to have an enclosure, which helps keep dust out and that kind of stuff. But, you know, the wood that it's built with, it's very easy for me to finish it off right with a satin or a varnish, clear gloss varnish or whatever, because I know how to do it. I've done it so much. And I love that feel. I really love my home. I'm a home person. I like to, when I'm in here, I want to be comfortable, and it's a small little space. So I've got that, you know, feel. And I still have a lot of pride in what I do. And it makes me feel good that, you know, it's kind of neat. People enjoy it. I enjoy it. So, but yeah, all the stuff is very boaty, you know. I mean, that's not necessary, but that's just habit. Like drilling
closer.
Those holes, you know, I think in ounces.
Mm-hmm.
When I was messing with airplanes, you know, weight is everything. Weight is everything on a boat. You keep the weight down. So I lighten everything. You know, I drill lighting holes in steel. I do it in wood. I don't need massive pieces for a certain job. You know, lightweight stuff. Most of the stuff in here is boat building woods, other than most of the trim is just pine right from Home Depot. The framing in the walls is Sitka spruce, which is a quality wood for boat building, for spars and masts, that kind of stuff. And I had that at the shop, so that's why I used it. The plywood is a kind of an exotic plywood for boat building, kind of spendy, but it's very lightweight and stiff.
Where would you get it, the plywood?
Generally, you'd have to order it unless you were in a coastal area or something where there was extensive boat building going on. But it's available throughout the United States. It's an African wood. This particular, what they call a kumi. But it's the best plywood you can buy. And it is spendy. But in the overall cost of the overall project, it's not. Especially, it's so easy to finish out.
May we see what's underneath this box?
This here? Sure.
Is that this propane?
Yeah. That's the only, well, not, this is propane, the only appliance, and then I have a catalytic heater, an Olympian, and that's...
Is it easy to get to see it?
Yeah, it's on a...
I was going to ask you what you do to stay warm in here.
I used to have, remember I had a wood burner. Mm-hmm. And I took it out because I wasn't using it. And that was in this corner, and I needed more cabinets. But I have a quick disconnect on here, and also a 8.5-foot hose. So I can move this around if I want to. I hardly ever move it past, you know, this stays coiled, and if I use it, it's usually sitting.
And why do you have a cover over that? Is there a specific reason?
Yeah, dust. They don't like dust. They have kind of it's not fiberglass. It's a fibrous material that they use to, in there. And that's what wears out. And eventually you can replace this stuff. But if you keep it clean, it'll last a hell of a lot longer. This particular stove I had in another rig is 5 years old. And we live in a really dirty, dusty environment in the desert for the most part. So keeping it clean is important.
What's the BTU output of that size?
15 and 3,000. It's two settings.
Okay.
And it heats this place just fine. You know, it's in 20 degree weather the other night in Williams, and I fired it up after the sun went down for about an hour, and it was 75 in here, and you know, nice and toasty.
Williams is about 8,500 feet.
Yeah, it's up there. Yeah, it was cold. A beautiful day, but boy, it got cold at night.
So you've got your windows, your cooktop, a stainless steel sink that you just use a water jug.
Yeah.
Keeping it simple, no sense in getting a pump and having a bunch of complicated plumbing when you can just set a water jug up there.
That's my reasoning.
I do the same thing.
This is easier than screwing with a faucet or even, you know, electric pumps and all, or plus a lot cheaper. This is $6, I think, at Walmart. But, you know, that water, you just tap it, you know, if I want to put a little water. It's so convenient. And I couldn't do any bigger, but they make these, you know, up to 2.5 gallons. It's fancy porcelain, stainless, you know.
Right.
That works just great.
Let's spin around and take a look at your very unique bath. And so the first thing I notice is wood. And normally, one wouldn't see wood in a bath. Tell us how you're pulling that off without doing any damage to the wood.
Okay. Again, very boaty. In the last 30 years, epoxy has become the standard in the industry for glue and for sealing in the marine industry and many other things. Just the same way as you'd build and seal an outside hull of a boat, although this doesn't have fiberglass cloth or any matrix built into it, but it's all clear coated. It's built and then clear coated with three coats of clear epoxy and sanded. And when I say built, they're built in panels. That's the actual wall of the outside.
Okay.
So that was in, but these pieces, front and two sides, are built on the ground and on the table and then clear coated, let gravity work before you let it flow out, sanded, and then there's just a few coats of light satin varnish, the same varnish I use for the interior, but the seal is the epoxy. And if you can see the corners down there, they're radiused and up there. That's what they call filleting in boat building, and it's a structural joint primarily. There's no other framing, no other screws or anything mechanical to hold that together. It's just the epoxy fillet. But it also makes a nice clean corner where dust doesn't collect. Or water, it'll run off. So that's why it's sealed, and I can have a wooden one without it buying an external shower stall, making whatever. And it works just fine, and it'll last forever. You don't want water standing any place, even over epoxy or anything, if you can help it. So this is all.
Where's the drain?
The drain's back in the corner, way down on the floor. If you might be able to see it down there, is a little. The floor,
I don't know if it's
the false
picking up.
Floor.
It looks like you have a wet bath because you've incorporated a toilet. Tell us about this toilet. This is special. This isn't your typical porta potty.
No, this is a composting toilet, store bought. Nature's Head is the manufacturer's name. There's
okay.
Two small ones on the market like this. That's the smallest footprint you can get. Airhead is one, Nature's Head is the other. This guy started the other company with a friend, went on his own about 15 years ago, made some improvements to the thing. So I bought it. I've had them on boats, and I've installed them. And I love them. both of them have this great urine diversion tank right here. And that's great for gallons. And it's convenient. You just pop the lid up, pull that 2-gallon container out, and go dump it. That's a nice factor. Convenience. It's also, moisture is a killer for compost, and you keep it as dry and as hot as possible for it to do its natural breakdown of the feces and everything else. You know? So you want to keep it just, and that will drain right into that. So very, very convenient. They're not cheap. They're about $900.
So that costs you about $900, yeah. And you can go out and empty the urine because it's separated. How do you have to empty the other stuff, or?
Yeah, it'll just break down, and it's just like buying peat moss. Peat moss is what you put in it, mm-hmm. originally when you clean it, when you start out. And it's just an absorbent, and it helps the breakdown process, produces heat. And when you empty it, it looks like the stuff you, a little tricky to do the urine diversion thing, you know, if you were going to build it yourself. But I was going to mention that a minute ago, that it's very buildable. You don't need to spend $900. I was in a hurry. I just recouped from a major operation. My house was sold. This was almost done, so. But all along, I was going to buy it. I was going to, you know, put it in the budget instead of build one this time. I had enough stuff to build with the whole overall project, so. But yeah, I love it. One thing I wanted to say is that this is waterproof. It's all stainless steel and a composite construction. But I take this out when I shower.
Lift it out?
Yeah, it has a little 12-volt wire for a tiny little muffin fan. And I have a special little hookup. It comes with its own little connector. I didn't like it. It was flimsy and it kept breaking. So I just put this waterproof one on here. And that's it. And it runs this little tiny fan over here. You can go either side. It comes that way. And also you can put, you have a little gear shift over here for first, second, third, and fourth gear that you want to spin the crap up.
Okay.
You can go on either side with that too. So you can mount it just around here if you want. But other than drying this thing off, which is just kind of laziness, I thought one day, well, I'll just take it out. Unplug it. I just set it there. Now I can stand in there and take a shower more comfortably than sitting on the thing. So now I have to dry anything. I squeegee this and most of the water's already gone, and wipe it down and put the toilet back in and good to go.
And I think it's also noteworthy to mention that standing here beside the toilet, there's no outgassing at all. It's not an unpleasant environment because this toilet's sitting here. Yeah.
That's the utmost positive about this thing. Even, it's open, you know. There's nothing there. There is absolutely no odor. You can see the spinner. And when you dump this thing, which I do on the first of every month,
uh-huh.
part of my maintenance program for batteries, crapper, the whole thing, there's not a whiff of a toilet of any kind, of any design. It's absolutely nothing, which is really nice. It takes me 15 minutes, you know, to clean it and put it back in. I use a 2-pound bag of composting stuff, the peat moss. And that's cheap. You can buy a 40-pound bag at Home Depot for about $15.
It'd be great to see the RV companies start to go this direction, huh?
Yeah, too much money, you know.
I suppose.
They would rather, you know, that's profit. They put in the biggest thing, I think, why it's not there, even over money, which is the almighty in that mentality usually, is that convincing the general public.
Mm.
I'm shitting in a bucket still.
Right.
Yeah. And that's hard to do, change the public. So let's just make it like the home. You know, we got a little flusher and everything. It's just like home. It's not gonna, until whoever is in charge of that, which is usually one of us guys, to dump.
Right.
Yeah.
What else can you show us about your rig?
Well, I think that's about it. Dinette table, easy. You know, it's just right there. Goes up on its two people. You could do this. You could do fold up. You know, all kinds of ways. We talked about the lighting. I think that's it.
And you chose a stool rather than a chair, not only because it provides more room, but it's better to sit on to play the guitar.
I've had this for years, and that is a guitar playing chair. That's primarily, it's function. But I usually eat on this side, off the table, and then sit here. Okay, this is storage under here, but it's a little more comfortable than that. But it's the guitar stool. Fits back in the little guitar room now, just quite nicely.
In closing, what would be a message that you would offer to anyone that's thinking about doing this, whether they be already retired or just looking into it at a younger age? From you've got a whole lifetime worth of experiences.
Boy, that's a hard one, James. everybody has a different view and values of. I did this by choice primarily. I was ready, like I mentioned earlier. But there was a little necessity here, too, because I knew I would be a slave to my property and my home. I would have to work way more than I wanted to maintain it. Property taxes are going up. I had a little rental on my property. It needed stuff. When you own a home, it's astronomical. Just taxes alone, let alone. And mine was very inexpensive considering other people. I put half down on my house when I, or my property. I built the house. I was going to have to continue working at maybe a job that I didn't want. My businesses started going because of 208. I also did guitar work. I had a little guitar shop along with my boat stuff. And I'd really downsized when I moved to downtown area and in the boat stuff. But people weren't spending money. So all this was the writing on the wall. I better, if I'm going to do this, I better, do it now. And then the hospitalization and the illness that I had kind of gave me the shot, kicked in the ass and said, go do it. But I really can't give any advice. I mean, if you want it, yes, I can. Do it now. Don't worry. If you're 20 years old, don't give up the whole game, because you need money in this world no matter what. But you don't need a lot of it. But do it. Don't say, I will, because 95% of the people in this country, especially when you're traveling out here, you say, boy, I wish I would have done that. And then you die. So, do it now. There is a median there, Try to get some bucks for later on. I would always take off. I don't have much money because if somebody would come and say, hey, I'm going to deliver a boat to Tahiti, that's a no-brainer. If I didn't have a project going in the shop, I closed the doors and I went. And I'm really happy I did that. But for the most part, this is great. I've had some personal issues in the last year or so that have made life a little. But I'm working through it. But just go do it. Whatever it is.
Thank you so much for taking time.
You bet.
When we did our original video, there were so many people that had commented that they wanted to see more of you. So I'm coming through with my promise, because I promised them. I said, next time I see Lou, I promise I'll get more of this. And so I really appreciate you taking some time to do this. I'm really enjoying your presence in camp, and I look forward to us hanging out for as long as it lasts out here.
Well, it's good to see you too. And I'd just like to say in closing also, if this is very unique, it's hard to miss this rig. If somebody sees me. I don't want to do much work anymore. I'm kind of burned out, but my advice, for whatever it's worth, is free. So if you just want to see the rig, say, hey, I got all the time in the world.
Very good. Well, cool, man. Thanks a lot.
You bet.
And we'll see you guys on the next video. If you guys liked the video of Lou here, please subscribe to the channel. And if you have a friend that might benefit from it, please share it. And we will see you on the next round. Thanks a lot. See ya.